too. Check 1 2 1 2. Who got more style than Sundew? Check 1 2. Yo, I'm hot.
Ballin'!
Pace, Pace.
Hip hop is dead. Nigga mortis has set in. Rigor mortis has set in. Now what? It's that energy. I feel it. Forget us. It's the generation behind us. These are the ones who are gonna pick up the baton. So the rappers always saying, yo, all I'm doing is rapping about what I see. Who put them things there for you to see? There are a lot of people involved with the death or so-called death of hip hop. When this nigga picked up the microphone, that was the first sign that hip hop was about to die. And I'm not saying hip hop is dead. We're gonna examine this thoroughly to find out if hip hop is really dead, if it's on life support. Give it up for the DJ. Hip hop is alive and well out here in Toronto.
Rich ass niggas is riding with three llamas, revenge in their eyes, Hennessy in the ganja.
All right, y'all. I want y'all to put your hands together and to bring on a brother that's bound to lay more dips in your hips, more glide in your stride. If you don't think it's mess, you got the wrong damn address.
Bro.
Pace, Pace. Thank you, appreciate it.
Give it up for the DJ.
1, 2, okay. Can everybody see the screen? All right. I see this mic don't have a lot of in play, but that's okay. I wanna thank you for taking time out of, you know, your busy schedule to come out and help me usher in the death of hip hop. I call this lecture Hip Hop is Dead because that's what Nas' new album is called. And I'm going to release this DVD the same day he released his album. Why not? See what pops off.
But it's something that we need. Am I coming through clear on the camera?
Yeah.
I'm coming through clear on the camera. I really don't need this. I'm generally speaking loud. Like I was saying, I want to thank people for coming out. Peace, brothers, sisters, elders. Because it's a serious issue, and I love to talk about hip-hop, and I talk about it with a great deal of passion, and you're not going to be upset that you took time out of your schedule to come build with me about the culture of music. Hip-hop. Hip-hop is dead. Rigor mortis has set in. Rigor mortis has set in. Now what? And we must deal with it from that aspect because there are a lot of people involved with the death or so-called death of hip-hop. And I'm not saying hip-hop is dead. We're gonna examine this thoroughly to find out if hip-hop is really dead, if it's on life support, as the sister said earlier. Has it ever truly existed since, you know, Bambada and Herc and things of that nature? So. I had a DVD I wanted to play. It had some music, some authentic hip-hop breakbeats, but during my travel, the CD got messed up. So I usually use that to serve as the ancient drummers who do the drumming when we come together for these type of events. And it was some of the most classic breakbeats that you'd ever hear from the parks in Cedar Park and during those days, because that's the era of hip-hop I'm from. Kool Herc started hip hop, I bear witness. I've been in the park to see Kool Herc do it. My mother said, if you leave the block, you can get your butt whipped. I would leave the block. That's just a butt whipping I had to have because you knew that this music, this was a magical time. And there was something special going on with the music at that particular time. So that's just a butt whipping you knew you was gonna get because you had to go in the park and bear witness and take part of this new phenomenon called hip hop. Now, we call it hip-hop, and we give Herc credit for starting hip-hop, but hip-hop is nothing new. I say this on all my DVDs. We've been banging on drums, writing on walls, dancing, and the Oracle's been speaking since the beginning of time. But we call it hip-hop because it had a certain energy to it, and that energy became the way we walked, the way we talked, the way we did it, the way we, instead of carving them images into the walls, we got the spray paint and we put those images up, but there were still images that had to go up to express what was inside. We had to bring it out. The art in itself is, I like to say, making the physical or the unseen seen or the unheard heard. You use art to do it. So whatever's going on in your mind, if you are a graph artist, you're bringing things from the astral plane into a physical existence with your art. You're bringing things from the astral plane into a physical existence with your art. You may be the only one who can do those images in that particular way, because you know, like I know, you can look at some art pieces and don't know what they mean, because they mean something different to each and every person. The melanin within our bodies manifests or reads that art differently. This is why you see, you know, people sit around and drinking champagne and they're discussing an art piece. And the discussion may take hours because this is what they see. Pictures tell 1,000 words. You've heard the saying before. You know what I'm saying? So we understand that when you see an image, it's supposed to mean something different to different people. No different than the way we dance. You can watch a child dance. You've never taught this child how to dance. This child can hear a certain rhythm or music, and that child will immediately start to dance on rhythm. This is something you inherit. It's the rhythm. It's the way we do it. No different than the oracle speaking. We've all been around for years, and you're great. Aunt or something, when she or he speaks, everyone gathers around because they know that that particular elder holds that history. So if I wanted to know how my mom's was when she was a child, I had to sit down and let grandma tell a story. Don't let your mother tell a story, because she's going to have her own twist to the story. You speak to the elder, and the elder's going to tell you what this was and what that was. And like I said, the way we dance, it's always been sacred. It's always sacred the way we move our bodies. Our ancestors used to make it rain when we danced. Or, you know, things of that nature, when birth, or we were celebrating life and this and that, we danced. Very critical. So those are the four basic elements. And of course, the drummer became the DJ. You know, when life, or we was going to war, we pounded the drums. We pounded the drums for numerous reasons. And the Zulus in particular would pound those drums so hard when they was going to war, they would scare whoever they was going against, because they would hear those drums coming and the Zulus would be 3 days away. This is how hard they was pounding the drums, 3 days away. Okay, so the power of that drum is phenomenal in our life. And when you hear that music, no matter what you're doing, you're gonna stop. So once they started taking the instruments out of school, because an instrument, it's a spirit catcher. If you want to manifest the spirit within you, you use instruments to do it. So whether you playing the drums or guitar, so a lot of the diabolical ones understood that. So they had to get those instruments, because why else would you take instruments out of school? Unless you understand what's really going on with us as a people. So we were using these instruments, just as they said, as instruments to bring the unseen, seen, capturing into the astral realm, bringing this stuff into a physical existence. So once they took these instruments out of the school up in the South Bronx, now we have conjured up energy inside of us that must come out somehow, some way. So we began to beatbox, because that what became the essence of the drum. You can't stop the drum. We got spray paint cans and start putting those images up. Brothers start breakdancing. I can't do it no more. I used to spin on my head as a child. Can't do it no more, but we started manifesting through that way. And brothers always talk slick, so we started talking slick and rhythm. That's all it was. We started making it rhyme and things of that nature. So those are the four basic elements that have followed us since the beginning of time. So out of them taking something away from us, they created something else. And we're gonna talk about that, because we're gonna get into the different definitions of death. What does death really mean? Does it mean death, or does it mean life on a whole nother realm? What does death really mean? Does it mean death, or does it mean life on a whole nother realm? So once you take away one thing, we will manifest our spirithood in another way. So that's what brought hip hop about. And the first essence of it was talking about our conditions and things of that nature. You know what I'm saying? Using it as something to bring the people together, it became alchemy. Earth, air, fire, water. And that's why I took the elements, the basic elements of hip hop. I showed the spiritual connection to it, but I also gave you the earth, air, fire, and water, because that's the composition of everything. Those are the basic elements of life. We start life, and life begins with earth, air, fire, water. So my job is to show you the spiritual connection to everything we do. So even hip hop has a spiritual foundation. Not now. This is shit hop, excuse my French, now. But in its origin, hip hop had a power. It had an energy about it. It had a movement about it. So when you add earth, air, fire, water as an alchemist, you know what I'm saying? Alchemists are able to take base metals and turn them into gold, or take lead, as the story goes, turn it into gold. So when that lead from the pencil hit the pad and we began to do what we do, we started manifesting things on a gold level. Gold records, gold teeth, gold chains, but it's just showing you the manifestation of the basic elements. I say all of that to say, let's get started. All right, hip hop is dead. Like I said, we'll examine death in the regular dictionary, European dictionary. The definition of death is the cause of loss of life, the end of life, cause of ruin, all right? However, in this particular dictionary here, I don't have a lot of copies. I only have just one copy. It's called The Functionary. And it's a brother, his name is Dr. Blind. I believe he's out of Detroit. And he took the basic dictionary and added funk to it. He added a melanin essence to the dictionary to show you, first of all, the English language is not our language. We do know this. And language can become a part of a trap, get you caught into something, because when you speak someone else's language, they will control you. And we're gonna talk about that because, not to get off the subject, bear with me, because I'm gonna be all over the place. I don't usually follow any format. When the thought hit me, the spirit comes in, I just speak about it. We're gonna talk about the language of Na'amin. That's the hip hop language, Na'amin. And we're gonna talk about that because that's an actual language, because we said it is. We created it, Na'amin. You see what I'm saying? So it enabled us to bend the reality, so to speak, because when we're speaking proper English in this particular manner, and it's not our language, it boxes us in. It traps us, no different than the slaves would teach. They had these certain lingos, you know what I'm saying? When they was gonna escape, they put it in songs, and you thought it was just a song. No, but it meant, yo, we getting out of here at 12 o'clock, noon, follow the stars. So we always spoke a different language in which slave masters didn't know what the hell we were talking about. So, the language of Na'amin is a way to bend, not necessarily break, but bend the reality that we have been boxed into. In the Matrix movie, you know, Morpheus told Neo certain rules can be broke, certain rules can be bent, all depending on how you're going about it. So a lot of people may look at the brother saying, Na'amin, that's just some straight low vibration stuff, but my job is to show you the spiritual essence in everything we do. So we learn to speak our own language because this is not our own language. Now, with that point made, once you start seeing bling bling in the dictionary, that word no longer has that power because now it has been incorporated into a European system. So now they can use bling bling and steal the vibration off the word. So we gotta be careful with the language we speak. However, anywhere we go, I may not know the language verbatim, but I can speak to a brother from Canada and he may say something and I may not know exactly what he's saying, but I can figure it out. Even though I've never been here, well, I've been here a long time ago. I've been here 15 years ago, as I was mentioning to the sisters earlier. As a part of a rap artist, I was with Tim Dogg. We came through in 90 or 91. It was such a long time ago, and I didn't really have time to interface with the people the way I'm doing now. It was like shoot in, get on stage, get off the stage, yada, yada, yada. So this brother's Dr. Blind took and made a spiritual sort of dictionary. So his definition of the same word is a transition of spirit into a higher vibration of energy, oscillating resonance, the origin of life. So here it is, you have a European dictionary saying it's the end of life, but the brother saying, hold on, death on one level means life on a whole nother level. It is the origin of life. So when we talk about hip hop is dead, we want to examine if this particular cycle of hip hop is dead and we're about to go into something new, which may be good. Change is always good. That's why we probably see a lot of the nonsense going on now, because whenever people reach such a low level, then that's the end of it. It can't get no lower than what it is now. If you've been watching TV like I've been watching TV, Flavor Flav, Flavor of Love, anybody seen this? It can't really get no lower. And if it can, we better brace for something. If it can get lower than that, we in for a long ride. So we want to look at it from many different perspectives. And I'll speak about hip hop and things in general. I try not to get one dimensional with it. I try to look at it from a lot of different angles, because there are many different angles in which we must view this. All right, hip hop is dead. Let's go to the word rhythm artist first. This was in the dictionary. It wasn't in the functionary, so I used the regular joint. Stiffness of death, temporary rigidity of muscles after death. So you know when you die, that rigor mortis kick in is done. Nigga mortis, this is just my breakdown of this. This is just me twisting the language. The inability of niggas to move forward. Stuck, lazy, complacent, spiritually dead. So we could be functioning, but if we spiritually dead, that's gonna be nigga mortis. And for the lack of better term, so I'll explain all the nigga stuff, because big hoopla going on with this too. So we'll explain that. Rigor mortis. Ah, can't leave white people out. The fusion of white people's energy and ideas into the energy field of black people to stop the flow, again, which is death, of consciousness and upward mobility. So if we're going to say hip hop is dead, we just can't say black people killed it. We got to look at the ones who are really controlling hip hop from a financial standpoint, the ones who control what images are seen by your children on the television, what songs are heard on the radio every single day. Black people don't have no control over that. As much as we would like to think we do not. So for me to come in and look at the effects of something and not the cause is an injustice. Dealing with metaphysics, you're always trained to look at the cause of things as well. So we gotta go upstairs and say there's other people involved, especially white people purchase 75% of all hip hop. A lot of people don't know that. They think we the ones buying, no, we dubbing it. We buying bootlegs. That's what we do. And it's sad, but that's just the way it is. And I buy bootlegs, I'm gonna say that on camera. And I don't feel I'm taking no money out of the rapper's pocket, because I know the rapper get 25 cent off an album. 30 cent if he lucky. Maybe a dollar if his name is Jay-Z or Jeezy or somebody, maybe. But the artist, and I've been an artist, and I've signed bogus contracts, and I'm telling you, they don't make a lot of money. This is why nowadays what they're doing is they're making their money off the residuals, ringtones, other things like that. And now they're even incorporating that in the contracts, so the labels get that money too. They're gonna have to turn this heat off temporarily, because I'll start sweating beads up here in a minute. And I'm just getting started. So if we can turn it off and then turn it back on for a few minutes, you know, just kind of, huh? Oh, okay. Oh, you know, once we get focused, we're gonna generate energy anyway. So once we get focused and get in what we're doing, we're gonna be okay. All right, hip hop is dead. Again, hip hop is energy. And energy cannot be destroyed, as we know. Energy just takes on a new form of energy. Can't be destroyed. So if hip hop is an energy, and energy, let's look at it like anything we focus our energy on, we give life to. So if you take a blonde-haired, blue-eyed Jesus Christ statue, and millions of people focus their energy on this, they create a living thing. It's got energy to it, and it's energy that's above you, because you've given off your power, your center to it. You've made it supreme over you by your thought process, and this goes on all the time. However, anything that we focus a lot of energy on has life. So hip hop is an energy. Energy can never be destroyed, it can only be transformed. So when we say hip hop is dead, perhaps again, we're gonna transform this music into something else. However, I just got finished telling you what brought hip hop about was the crime, the poverty, no jobs, and brothers and sisters having to express themselves, them taking the elements out of the, the instruments out of the classrooms. All of this gave, set the stage, so to speak, to bring about hip hop. They knocked off the Black Panthers, you know, they knocked off Malcolm, Martin, so all of our so-called leaders, they flooded the hood with heroin in the 70s, speaking from, you know, the states and stuff, and were sedating a lot of the up-and-coming warriors. So the ones who weren't affected, so to speak, began to express themselves in different ways. That brought about hip-hop. Without that, hip-hop wouldn't exist, not in its true essence and form, because we had to voice our opinion about police brutality. We had to voice our opinion about the fact that we didn't have no jobs in our neighborhood. We had to voice our opinion, and by us putting it to music, just made it more of a spiritual thing, more of a spiritual movement, so to speak. So, in this day and time, another thing, brothers didn't have much back then. And that also played into the essence of what hip hop had become. Nowadays, these so-called brothers think that they have made it. And because they think that they have made it, they high on the hog now. It's no reason for them to create anything new, so to speak. Because the illusion now is that we have made it. And the television has a lot to do with that. When you see these videos, brothers iced out, cars that are not theirs, MTV cribs, rented, not their stuff, but it gives off the perception, look at black people. And these images go all over the world. Don't think they go all over the world to say, look at our once oppressed, slave-bitten people who were down in the dumps. Look at them now. They don't show the hard-working mother who's struggling with two kids, she gotta work two jobs. They don't even show the good father who gotta work that second job to keep the roof over the head. They don't show our doctors, lawyers, astronauts. We have all of that. They don't show that on television. They show the rapper, the baller, the hustler. That's the image that they want to show. If I can get a nice cold one of those, like a frozen one or something, they don't show all of that. So what they do is, the way you perceive it, put it like this, your perception is based on the information that you input. So if the only thing given to you is this data that these our black people are ballers, our black women are hoes, sluts, they got their butt out and all that, if that's the only perception you have of us and that image goes all over the world, then that's who we are, so to speak. Or that's what they would like you to think who we are. And the perception, it's not about truth anymore, it's about the perception of truth. So whatever they put, if they defeat us in a movie, it's real. Because they're dealing with the perception, thank you, bro. They're dealing with the perception of truth. Because they know if they feed it to you and you buy into it, it now becomes real. So we gotta be very careful on the things we see and how they're using magic, our own magic, on us. We're the only ones who can make anything happen. We're the spiritual people of the planet. I think that's hands down. So, but if we buy into it, anything that goes on in Hollywood, we can make real. So they put these movies out to introduce that particular concept into our thought stream. And once it reaches enough people's thought stream and we meditate on it, it is now a reality. So any ideas that they want to enter, whether they want to make it law, all they do is introduce it and say, and then this is a mind trick they play on you. They say, 85% of the people up in Canada feel that being gay is the way to go. Now, they can say that, and they just doctored some numbers that don't even exist, because that's what they do. And then we go, why? Well, if 85% of the people say being gay is the way to go, then I guess being gay is the way to go. And once they continue to do that, keep in mind, this is magic. This is how they perform their magic. Once they continue to do that, it soon becomes a reality. I hate to say it that way, but I gotta keep it as raw as possible. All right, the birth of hip hop. Can everybody see that? Everybody can see that? All right, we're gonna look at it from a couple of different perspectives. As I said, no birth record, everything is everything. So a drummer in 2000 BC is a DJ today. Same thing, still manifesting beats, but just using different elements. We in a different vibration, we in a different time frame. But the DNA, as we're gonna speak about, we're gonna speak about that DNA in a minute, is what's key. Because they can alter and change certain aspects, but certain aspects of it will remain the same. So I can relate, I can say hip hop has no birth record, because we've been basically using those four elements of drumming, writing, the oracle speaking, and dancing since the beginning of time. But now we call this particular aspect of it, or this vibratory frequency of it, hip hop. Now, but when you name something, a lot of times you kill it. Because before we named it hip hop, it was chaos. It just was. We was just doing it. Once we gave it a name, we allowed those who couldn't comprehend what we were doing, once we name it, because that's what white people do, they name things to give them a better understanding of how to deal with it. So once we named it hip hop and gave it a format, now they can move into stage two, was to find out how to exploit it, because they don't care about the spiritual aspect of it. If the spiritual for us manifests into dollars for them, it's a go. Their whole concept is, how can we make money from this? How can this be something? Because their God is money. And I'm not even talking about white people. I'm talking about certain individuals who ride on that frequency. You could be blue. If you are in contact or your vibration is being affected, because if you hang out with non-broke people, chances are you're gonna be number 10. That's just a fact. So my mother used to say, watch who you hang out with. You know what I'm saying? If you're hanging out with brothers who want some thug and criminal activity, you're gonna get caught up in it sooner or later. Haphazardly or not, you will be caught up in it, or you'll be riding in the car that's dirty and you knew nothing about it. So we wanna be clear with that. Current vibrational frequency kicked in about 1973, 1974. That's when Herc came out into the park and all the elements began to converge. So the current vibrational frequency of it kicked in 1973, 1974, on my block. So I want you to understand the spiritual significance of what I'm bringing to you. I was a little kid, but I'm bringing you back the truest essence. It's like I was in the land of Atlantis when it came to hip hop. I saw the young guys putting it down, and because my father wasn't in my life at the time, you naturally levitate to the older guys on the block. You wanna do what they do, you wanna watch their style, you know what I'm saying? You naturally do that. You look up to them because you're looking for a male figure, and I just so happen to be looking up at Kool Herc and Africa Bambaataa and those guys. So I know a little bit about hip hop. That's all I'm basically trying to say. What or who brought this about, this energy? Now, I just got finished telling you that certain things have to be put in place to bring certain things about. If you're doing magic, you got to have certain elements in place. Magic is nothing but a mathematical, everything has to be precise. If you're a vampire and you live off the energy of the people and you really rely on those people, and you need them to bring about a new energy, you have to set the stage for them. Like, the harder they push you down, the higher you're gonna go up. So if you oppress us as a people, you take away the jobs, you kill off our leaders, you make housing, the housing situation is extremely, extremely bad. And you put a whole bunch of people in that situation, it will manifest something, especially being that we the people who we are. So the further and further we became oppressed, the more and more we wanted to fight back, the more and more we wanted to voice our opinion on what was really going on. So we need to also examine those who knew hip hop was coming about. I'm dealing with metaphysics here. I'm telling you, if I deprive you of something, if I say, look, cheeseburgers is banned in Canada from now on, and I keep, every time you see me, I'm eating cheeseburgers on TV, but they banned. You cannot have cheeseburgers. If I see you eating a cheeseburger, the police are gonna hit you in your head with the billy club. You're going to jail. All right? Let's just use that as a scenario. And then, all of a sudden, you're fighting because you want cheeseburgers. So all the people get together and form a movement. We want cheeseburgers. And then you finally break through, and now you have all the cheeseburgers you want. Okay? So this is to show you how they can control things by what they take away from you. And we're going to speak about that in detail, because all these brothers, we've been deprived of so many things, but the brothers in hip-hop now only seem to be focusing on the money aspect. Now they got a little bit of money, so they think they have made it. But we've been deprived of so many things. Education, our history, the list goes on and on and on, but I don't see these rappers fighting for our history or fighting for our mothers. I only see them fighting for money. And once they get money, they think they have made it, not understanding those who control the money game control you. If you will do anything for money, that means I hold that power. And I can make you get on stage on some Flavor of Love's nonsense. I can make you do anything I want you to do, because the bottom line is you need the money, or you want the money. You think you need the money. I grew up extremely poor and was extremely happy. You know what I'm saying? Because mama always made a way. You may not have got everything you wanted, but you got it. And we survived and we still here. So obviously money may not be the end all and be all. This is causing a lot of problems. Okay, what year was the energy transformed or circumvented from a positive to a negative? So when you look at hip hop in the 80s, and you had Public Enemy, and KRS-One, the X-Clan, Rakim, Big Daddy Kane, Poor Righteous Teachers, De La Soul, boom, boom, boom. They all had a message in the music. It was all one thing. They was all telling a story in different aspects of the story. And it was positive at that particular point. Even though moms may be like, boy, turn that noise off, certain things she could tolerate. Like, oh, I like KRS-One because he's saying something more. I like this one. At what point did it go from positive energy to a negative thing, where the more negative you can spit your lyrics, the more money you made, or the more so-called clout you got? At what point? So we need to examine that, and we will while we're here. I'm just still laying out, you know, laying the big picture out. How has this transformation affected our future? We need to talk about that too. How has this, it's a saying I use, is pre-existing conditions plus current thought stream equals future conditions. So rappers always say, yo, all I'm doing is rapping about what I see. Who put them things there for you to see? And if what you see is gonna mentally, because thought is everything, thought is the building block of all life. So if those thoughts are projected out and our future is based on what it is you see now, who planned it or set up the conditions of hard times for you to vibrate in, for you to get your thoughts from? So don't just look at the rapper and say, no, look at the conditions surrounding the rapper. You know what I'm saying? And because again, our magic is from here. All our magic is mental. And if I want to project positive thoughts for the future, I need to be in a positive setting, so to speak, now. But if the situation I'm in is always negative, it's always a low vibration, then it's going to be extremely hard to vibrate on a higher frequency at a later time. Can we do it again? I just got finished answering that question. At the present point, no, because we think we made it already. Hip hop came from that lowest of the low. But ain't nobody, everybody think we paid already. If you watch BET, Black Exploitation Television, if you watch that nonsense, you would swear black people, and again, I'm looking at it from a global perspective, we in the hood, we know better. But for those across the seas who are really dependent on what they see to make their judgment of who we are, they don't know. So they watch it, you know, even Oprah Winfrey went to Africa and they call her a nigga. It was like, what up, my nigga? Simply because they thought that, and they didn't mean it in a disrespectful way. They just was watching BET and figured this is how we greet each other. And that's not how we greet each other. It has become, which we're gonna talk about. We'll talk about that. All right? Okay. Take a shot of this too. Maybe this will help out. All right, the DNA of hip hop. We'll talk about four basic strands of DNA ATCG, I'm pretty sure the sister know what I'm talking about. There are four basic, is it five? Oh, okay. So, DNA is how we transfer information, among other things. It's embedded in us. Everything that we was, everything that we are, and everything that we will be is inside of the DNA. It's a language, and when you juxtapose these letters, A, T, C, G, they speak a language. Get my DVD, The Five Bloodlines of Hip Hop. My partner, Rich, goes in, he calls it the Twisted Twisted. So scientifically speaking, or you know, spiritually speaking, that language is through the DNA. Okay, so we wanna see how has this, but they are, the way they got it set up now, they can alter and change our DNA. About what we eat, what we think, what we drink, the environment. So they're playing with our future on levels that we may not be accustomed to or understand. Now, if there's four basic strands of DNA, I like to say there's four basic elements of life: earth, water, air, fire. Okay, so that's the EWAF. Those elements come together, and so by tainting the water, or tainting the air, that can also affect strands of DNA. It's all connected. All right? The four basic ancient elements, the hieroglyph, the dancer, the drummer, and the oracle. So that's where you get your A-D-D-O. This is, you ain't gonna find this in no science book. This is just me going in. This is just how I see it. This is the way my DNA is affected now, where I'm able to manifest things the way I see them. Now, the four basic elements of hip-hop, of course, is the graffiti, the DJ, the B-boy, and the MC. It's no coincidence we're still talking about four basic elements, from our spiritual DNA to our physical DNA. Now, if they can, because as above, so below, as within, so without. So what our ancestors always taught. So if they can manipulate us spiritually, they can also manipulate us physically, because physical is the lowest level. Spiritual is the highest level. All right, so they're tapping in on our DNA to bring about, because our DNA is constantly changing, mutating, and things of that nature. So they're tapping in on that because they are controlling our future. They don't just want to say, all right, we're going to teach them low-level information in school and make sure that all the food they eat is poison. That's one way of doing it. They do that as well. They are trying to tap in on and deal with us spiritually. And we're spiritual beings before anything else. I am a spiritual being having a human experience. This is a suit. I'm wearing it so I can come down here and hang out and talk to y'all. It's like going to space. You need a suit. So dealing in this third dimensional density, I gotta wear this suit. I beat the suit up sometimes too. I beat it up, I beat it in the ground, you know, whatever the case may be, because I know it's not me. I'ma dump it and put on another suit when this suit wear out. Other people cannot do that. There are entities on this planet who are stuck and locked in third dimensional, this is it. So they're gonna try to keep you here because they know you can move on. You can graduate, you come down here, you learn a few lessons, you bounce, you come back if you need to come back, learn something else, you might come back as a real fat person because maybe you need to understand what fat people look like or live like. Maybe, you never really know. Everything we do is a learning experience in some way or another. You might be in a relationship that just went bad. Ah, I hate that nigga. Well, maybe you had to learn that lesson so that when you run into a real brother or sister, you can appreciate that. Maybe. So I try not to look at things so one-dimensional. I'm trying to get a full a view of what's really going on, because we deep people, extremely. All right, let's get into the advanced DNA. Okay, same elements, but what they have, what they call junk DNA. They're calling it junk. Now, hold on. We're the most perfect specimens this universe has ever seen, and you mean we got junk in us? I don't think so. Watch the language. They calling it junk DNA because maybe they don't have it. Maybe they can't see them extra strands joining together the way we can. Now they got a nine-strand DNA somewhere in Africa, that's what I'm understanding. So you gotta watch Angela Jolie and Madonna and them going out and getting them black babies because they wanna help black kids. There's plenty of black kids here. Why are they going in? You know what I'm saying? Because that's where that DNA is beginning to mutate faster. Because they want, listen, McDonald's, you know they eat kids. You know they do that. Yeah, they do that. They literally eat babies. So I'm not saying that Madonna them gonna eat them babies, because then we'll be like, yo, Madonna, where that baby go? So Madonna, they're not gonna eat them babies, but them in general, they eat kids. You know how many kids be missing every year? That they never find? Never. Never. Where them kids going? During Hurricane Katrina, where them kids went? When you had them rich white boys going down there acting like they was helping with the cause, and they was reaching out to the mothers, give me your baby, give me your baby. And once they got them babies, they bounced.
They made sure to separate
everybody. Exactly, exactly. So I don't want to spook nobody out, but they eat babies. All right, that junk DNA, that's that melanin within us that we have that others do not have, that enables us to do the spiritual dance that we do. When I get to the elements of life, which is the earth, water, air, fire, again, ether. Ether, the spiritual essence, the triple darkness of space. Ether going on inside the womb of the black sister. And we're birthed within that triple darkness of space. The ancient elements was the hieroglyph, the drummer, the dancer, the oracle. Again, you're talking about that advances when you add the spiritual essence to those drums that you playing, or the spiritual essence to them glyphs that you put up on the wall. You're not just doing it, it's a certain essence to the way we do what we do. And you can hurt people by the intent that you put into your drum. Any producers here? Oh, okay, all right, so we're gonna talk about being able to use your art or your music as weapons. Because let's face it, any other weapons you use that'll be created by somebody else, how is that gonna hurt them? You can't fight the enemy on his plane and on his vibrational frequency. He is heavy into technology. He got weapons you couldn't imagine. You could not even imagine the weapons that they're using nowadays. We can't win that war. That's devil business. Forget about that. You must fight on the realm in which you are the strongest. And when we start truly understanding that and linking our thought process and our energy as one, it's over. It's done with. Nobody can do nothing to us. And that can happen by beating the drums or playing a bass guitar. If while you're sitting there as an alchemist, you're putting that certain energy into those certain chords. Because when you hit certain musical notes, they vibrate on certain chakras and open you up in different kind of ways. This is why you can listen to a beat by Dr. Dre, and the beat itself will open up your chakras, and then they'll dump all that negative on the lyrics, and it still reaches inside your subconscious. The beat, the drum, will take you. This is why in Africa, they banned us from playing the drums as slaves. They said, listen, I know y'all do some spooky stuff and all, y'all can't have that drum. Because what's happening is y'all beating them drums, and slave masters is coming up missing. You see what I'm saying? Because we spoke that language. We understood what that meant. So they literally banned the drum in ancient, well, in slave, so-called slave times. Hip-hop elements, graffiti, DJ, B-boy, MC, Africa Bambala said the fifth element of hip-hop is knowledge. All of them fifth elements from all the way up the line is the same thing. Knowledge, spirit, ether, melanin, they're all the same thing. Just it's manifested differently. If you understand the power that you have and who you are is what brings all those other elements together to make you the force that you are. If you do not know, then that energy is being used by somebody else all the time. I don't care if it's sexual energy. If you just busting nuts to bust nuts, you're still giving off a vibrational frequency that those who know what time it is can eat that energy the same way you would eat jerk chicken. Because they live off of energy. Keep that in mind. We're talking about energy, not necessarily people. All right? People is one thing, but energy is something totally different. So I want to make that clear as well. All right, the language of hip-hop, as I said, now I mean, DNA speaks a specific language. Hip-hop speaks a specific language. Mother Nature also speaks a language. When Mother Nature's pissed off, she burns some shit down, or bring in some hurricanes. That's Mother Nature cleansing the earth the way she knows how to cleanse it. And if you get caught up in that, then maybe your vibration, because again, energy is only gonna recognize energy. when Mother Earth comes through to do her thing, she's not gonna say, oh, that's a white man or a black man. It's how your energy is vibrating. So color don't matter. If you thinking like somebody that you are not, you get caught up in the storm. Animals deal with energy. Babies deal with energy. Hand your baby to somebody whose energy is twisted. Immediately. Like, mommy, what are you doing? Same thing with your dog or your cat. Motherfucker. You see what I'm saying? Because they're dealing with energy. They're not dealing with that's a white man or black man or whatever. They're dealing with energy. And as I broke down earlier, the language of Nami is the language of Nami. You know what I'm saying? Shun, that's a language. Because we said it is. And we all agree upon it. And once we make the agreement, it is. Everybody follow me so far? All right. What is hip hop? Before we can say hip hop is dead, we also need to examine what it is. And it's different things to different people. This is a part of the problem. This is why right now, all them Dirty South rappers is beefing with Nas because he said hip hop is dead, and for them hip hop is not dead, hip hop is alive, and you know what I'm saying? So it means different things. It could be, it's a means of economic empowerment and financial freedom. Look at P. Diddy and the boys. They paid. So for them, this is what hip hop means. Not necessarily that they need to make music to wake up their people, or understanding that we in one global struggle and the music that we use is a part of that vehicle to help us raise our consciousness and get out of this nonsense. No, it's about economic empowerment. For them, for that aspect or that cluster of so-called MCs, a means for spiritual advancement. You get some rappers that don't give a ish about selling records. Or, you know, that's not their purpose. Their purpose is to put out good music because it does something for them. Music heals us all the time. All the time. I'm a big Al Green fan, and when I go do it, I throw Al Green on, and all the problems seem to disappear for a while. Because the music gives me the ability to let my imagination run wild. It enables me to open up on levels that nothing else can. And you zone out. Whatever your song is, just like certain music can make you riled up and you're ready to fight. You watching a movie, you go to the movies, and why do you think they play certain music at certain time? Like a nigga running and shit, the music is not slow. No, because they want you to get charged into that. A love scene take place and the music is all slow and damn, man, you know, yeah, man, that is serious right there. So they do that because they understand music is gonna open you up. All right? So for some, it's a means of spiritual advancement, especially the early elders. I'm gonna show some pictures of them in a few minutes. Not that they knew that they was doing it for that reason. It just became what it became. It's a means to express one's self artistically. Those who are just artists, who love putting words together or love playing music or something. Hip hop for them means that. And they got major beef with these so-called people who they feel are disrespecting that art form. Why do you think white people put all their kids in art early in life? Early, he'd be 3 years old, play the piano, Tommy. You know, he's like, damn, I'm three. You know what I'm saying? I want to watch Scooby-Doo or something. No, because they understand the power of the artistic aspect or the power of music. They understand this. So they getting them little Tommy and them in there early. You know what I'm saying? And as I said before, musical instruments are spirit catchers. All right? Okay, a culture or a way of life. You don't have to be an MC or a DJ to love hip hop. It might be the way you walk, son. It might be the way you got your hat tipped to the side. You know what I'm saying? That's speaking the language to me. That's saying, yo, he on the frequency. The way sister got her hat flipped back. You know what I'm saying? That's letting me know I'm feeling her frequency. You know what I'm saying? And that's how we link up and do what we do. So it may just be the way you live your life. You grew up listening to all of these artists, but you didn't ever become an artist yourself and never really wanted to. But you know when something's right and something wrong in hip hop because you was there, you watched it grow. It's like a little brother or a little sister. And you know when your sister get twisted, you know something going on. You know what I'm saying? Any of you got teenage kids, you know, like my middle son is 13 now, and his balls are burning. What I mean by that is he's at that age now where you could tell there's a change going on in him that he's about to experience life on a whole nother level now. You follow what I'm saying? And I could sense it because it's my child. You know when something is wrong with your child. When your child come in and sit on the edge of the bed and is quiet, mom gonna say, boy, what's wrong with you? I know you're here for something because that's your child. We birthed hip hop, so we understood when it was making its forward progression to when it got twisted. And now I can't even relate to my own child now because my child is taking advice or is influenced by forces outside of me. That's just the way I see the hip hop situation. Okay, a food source. I mentioned that we're talking about energy, so there are those who eat energy. It's just that simple. I can't water it down any other way. You ever talk to somebody on the phone, and when they have problems, and when you hang up the phone, you feel worse and they feel better? They just drained your energy. You didn't know it while it was going through. You thought you was helping them. No, you just fed them the energy they needed. And they was like, ooh, thanks for that meal. Bloop, and hung the phone up. And now you feel bad and you carrying the negative energy that they just transferred the negative energy to you and took your positive energy. There are those who are masters at that can come around black people in particular and understand that we melanated people and stand by you and invoke certain chants and drain your energy. This is what they do. If they put it like this, if the cops bust somebody in the head right now and 5,000 people start marching with the same energy, same chant and the same words, that's energy being released into the ethers. Those who know how to manipulate and go up and eat that, oh, they having a meal. You know how much food was out at Katrina? You know how much death, which is a food source for some, I mean, it's people who went out there with their apron on and bib and they wouldn't have meals off our energy, off death, off sorrow, off pain. Okay, so you gotta watch the people you keep in your circle because it could be around there just to drain your energy. It's one thing to give off a positive vibe and some people can come around and just take a little piece off. Appreciate being around that sister because she always got something positive to say. Or appreciate being around that brother because he always find a way to say the right thing at the right time, but don't drain me. Take what you need, because I may need at one point and vice versa. So our art form can also be a food source. A way to launder money. This is critical because a lot of the drug dealers in the early 80s, they got a special on BET right now, American Gangsters. I don't know if this is playing up here. And it's showing you a lot of these drug dealers in the 80s was making buku money and didn't have nothing to do with it. I mean, more money than you can imagine, because once that crack cocaine came through the neighborhoods, no matter what neighborhoods it was, it wreaked so much death. But those who were benefiting off of it by slinging had shoeboxes of money, 10, 20, 30 million dollars, 18 and 20 years old with nothing to do with it, because you can't. You know, you can't just walk around with a shoebox of $20 million. Hip hop became a way to launder a lot of that money. This is why a lot of these record labels today were founded on drug money. A lot of them. Jay-Z don't make no qualms about it. He tell you, I used to sling rock, flip my money. Now, I'm not saying that that's necessarily a bad thing when you can transfer something into something else, but not at the death and expense of your people. That's karma, you can't escape that. So you will have a price to pay for that. But America's built on that. America's built on that. On your blood, sweat, and tears. The mob do it all the time. That's a mob protocol. Go to the mob handbook, that shit is in it. Take this money, flip it, launder it. You see what I'm saying? So once brothers got hit to it, they wanna change the game up and make it seem like it's something that ain't been going on. It's been something going on for a while. So a lot of the young brothers, Al Poe and Fat Cat Nichols and Pappy Mason and Rick Ross and Michael Harris, they was making loads of money and some of them invested it into some other stuff, but hip hop became the main avenue to clean up that money because, you know, it's like going to the hood, finding a brother, yeah, I like you, sister, let me put some money behind you and, you know, so forth. So now I can go into a car dealership and I ain't gotta put the car in my aunt name. I could just go straight in and cut you a check, a company check, for that new Benz I wanna ride in. For some, it's not real music. It's just niggas making noise. You get some people who they just don't understand the culture. For them, it's just noise. Jigaboo. Boo, niggas beating on drums and nonsense. So we want to mention them as well because it means different things to different people. All right, so before we just classify it as dead, we need to sit back and express what aspects of it is dead, or, you know, as a whole, is it dead? Hip-hop's original mission, peace, unity, love, and having fun. That was the original mission of it. Afrika Bambaataa said that. In 2007, because this is where we at now, basically, there's no peace, there's no unity, no love, and ain't nobody having fun. And that's equaling death. Stagnation. Once things stop moving, they die. Motion is the first law of the universe. Everything is moving. Everything must continue to move, but once it stops moving, it dies. Hip hop is not moving right now. Everybody's saying the same things. Everybody want to be thugs. Everyone want to be gangsters, but it's not moving. It's getting cluttered. It's getting crowded in there. So yes, this particular aspect of hip hop is dying. But back in the day, even if we battled, you might see them same two MCs playing ball later or at the bar having a drink because it was never nothing personal. Now, if I got beef with you, you might come shoot my family up. This is how bad it's become with the music. That's bad. All right? Unity. We was all together. Everything. Even them groups who had beef with each other, they still was on the same accord. Bro, you do your thing. I do. Because MC Shan and KRS-One, you know, they had the famous Bridges Over, South Bronx Band. They was cool with each other. They ain't had no personal beef. It's just that my ideologies or my aspect, the way I want to flip my words and my style, may be different from yours. You know what I'm saying? So that's the way that all went down. Of course, like I said, there's no love. Everything is death right now. I'll kill you. I'll kill your moms. You know what I'm saying? Yada, yada, yada. That chick is a biatch in the hell. It's really, really low vibration stuff. And that will definitely equal death. All right, I want to just show a few pictures of some of the old school pioneers, the ones who helped weave that DNA of hip hop to, you know, in its original, this is the chaos realm of hip hop, as I say, because it had no true form, essence, or order. There were no records at this particular point where a lot of these guys, they were just in the park, expressing themselves, laying the template down for what hip hop will become. This is Chief Rocker Busy B, it's my boy. The first real solo MC, the first real, and his thing was about raising your vibration. And all of his party raps was, oh man, throw your hands in the air, we're gonna have a good time. You know, if you like McDonald's, if Scorpio, if you Virgo. So his whole thing was just about, you know, raising your energy up, let's go have a good time. Take your mind off the chaos that may be going on in your real life. So this is Busy B. Show a few. This is the Funky 4+1. A lot of y'all never even heard of these groups because they was before Wax. Funky 4+1, Shy Rock, Keef and them boys, Master Rob and them boys. Is that Master Rob? Dude. Funky 4+1 was the first ones to perform on Dick Clark's show back in 1981. Way, way back. And Keef, the one in the middle, he's still living in my hood. Much love for him. Afrika Bambaataa, the Amon Ra of hip hop, founder of the Zulu Nation. He was a prominent gang leader in the 70s and decided he wanted peace now. Guys, let's turn this gang stuff into some hip hop. And that's what he did. He transformed all of the gangs in his hood. He gave them some lessons, made them study, and said, listen, we on peace now. We about peace. We ain't on that violent nonsense no more. Afrika Bambaataa brought that about. 1973, Zulu Nation. So nowadays, it's reversed. Back then, it was all about gangs, and it transformed into hip-hop. Then it became hip-hop. Now it's transforming into gangs. You know what I'm saying? So now you've seen a reversal of fortune, so to speak. The Cold Crush Brothers. This may be the greatest hip-hop group of all time. They were the showmen. Their stage show was phenomenal. They battled anybody and everybody back in the days. Again, we're talking about before records. They put out a few records, but their strongest essence of when they did their thing was way before records. But they had a stage show that was phenomenal. And everyone knew where everyone was supposed to be. The DJ was on point. They wore matching suits. They could not be beat. So I just want to mention them. Crash Crew, this is a group from Harlem. They was also one of them original groups that represented the Harlem aspect of hip hop. They were no joke at what they did. This is Crazy Legs. I'm gonna just show a little, all the essence. This is a B-boy, Rocksteady Crew. So his thing was getting out there and manifesting his godhood while he was spinning on his head. He still does this. He's still incredible at it. All right, that's Grand Wizard Theater on the Fantastic Five. This group also became famous for battling the Cold Crush Brothers. Again, this was about pure heart. This wasn't about money. This wasn't about being a gangster. This was about us expressing ourselves, using our music. The DJ Grand Wizard Theater, I'll show another picture of him very shortly. Furious Five, Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five. Melly Mel put out The Message in 1982, maybe the most powerful rap record of all time, because what it did was, at that point, it began to deal with the social aspects of who we were. Child is born with no state of mind, blind to the ways of mankind. He told a whole story. He was telling my story, he was just telling all our stories. So at that point, hip hop prior to that point was really about partying. He came in and brought the social relevance, and it was called The Message, which was very key. There's a picture of Grandmaster Flash. He created cutting, not scratching, two turntables spinning back and forth. He was a showman. He would cut behind his back. He would cut with his mouth. He would do all these things back then. All right, so he was real, that was his thing. Kool Herc, father of hip hop, the first one to come out into the park and throw a jam and put that signal out, that frequency that brought a whole bunch of people together at one gathering. And then when people dispersed at that point, hip hop seemed to like quicken, because everyone, you know, wanted to do what Herc was doing. And he had the system called the Hercaloids. His speakers was gigantic. When he came out to the park, you could hear him four blocks away, because his system was phenomenal. This is Popmaster Fable, another B-boy, Rocksteady Crew guy, you know what I'm saying? He also is prominent in breakdancing and B-boying, and one of the founding fathers of it. Sha-Rock, this is the early female essence of hip-hop. She had all her clothes on, notice she's fully dressed, and she held her own lyrically. Sha-Rock, give her some love. This is Tacky 183, one of them graffiti boys, early guys, putting it down, leaving his signature. That's what we did. That's how he marked his territory with his glyphs. Show him some love. Grand Wizard Theodore created the scratch. So you're getting the history of hip hop now too. The Jicka Jicka, he created that. He studied under Grandmaster Flash. And when he was 13, he created the scratch. 13 being a powerful number when you're dealing with, you know, numerology and things of that nature. So he created the scratch at 13, and he also created a technique where he would pick the needles up and drop them down precisely at the part of the record that he wanted to play. And I've seen him do it blindfolded. He still can do it. And no one has been able to match that to this day. So we're talking about a brother who can feel the grooves on a record, feel the grooves and know what part of the record he wanted to play. Phenomenal. Now, groups don't even have a DJ. What part of the game is that? They got a deck machine or something, or a tape or something. It's not real now, it's artificial. Okay, this is Tracy 168, another graph dude. Manifesting his godhood and his element. Look at the piece on the wall behind him. And you know, that language spoken wasn't for everybody. Like, I could never figure out what the hell that said half the time, but you get some who can walk right up on the pitch and say, yo, that says this and that and that, because they had the vision to see that. Me, I'd be like, yo, I don't know what that said. I appreciate it, but I don't understand what it says. All right, this is the Treacherous Three, Special K, Kumo D, L.A. Sunshine. Again, one of those powerful pioneering groups. And for me, this particular group was important because Special K lives around my way, or he did at one point. So again, I was able to look up to him and learn about hip hop from the ones who was the creators. Kumo D was my favorite MC of all time. And the group as a whole, to me, had the perfect balance of MCs. You know how back in the day, some group may have one phenomenal MC and the rest of them might have been okay. This was the premier group because all of them was on an even keel. Kumo D might have got a little bit more light, but them boys was all off the hook. All of them. Shit, LA Sunshine, give anybody a run for their money. Now, we're gonna move into another aspect or essence of what we're talking about. Everybody okay?
Yeah.
All right, because we're just getting started. All right, hip hop is dead. This is what Nas said. But I want you to take a look at this and tell me, is it just me, or does this make any kind of sense? Jay-Z calls himself God, and Nas is calling himself God's son. So is anybody confused on why they got together? This is, I'm looking at it metaphysically. Just want to show you some things where things seem like they're one way on one level, but they're fixing something on a whole nother level. Because they speak a language, and we need to all become more symbol literate. Because these diabolical ones are not speaking English. Because if they spoke English, shit, we'd all know what the hell they got planned. So they're talking to each other and conveying messages using symbols. Whether it be hand symbols, colors, certain other signs. So for them to keep us off base, in is out, up might be down, left might be right, blue might be green. So their whole language is to keep us off base because they speak the hidden language. So when you see God and God's son joining forces, that's a Christian thing, so to speak. That's you know what I'm saying? That's what took place, or that may be what is taking place on this particular level. As I showed you, Christ, he died at 33, so to speak, as the story goes. We're not gonna get into that. That'd be a whole nother lecture in itself. And then he was resurrected after 3 days, ascended into the kingdom, let's keep that in mind, of heaven. That's the gist of the story. Nas, at this present point, is 33 years old. Nas is the one who's saying hip-hop is dead because he is the embodiment of hip-hop. So at 33, the same point when Christ died, Nas is saying hip-hop is dead. We're gonna go in on this. All right, Nas has got a concert coming up at the Nokia Theater in New York on December 22nd. Now, the reason that date struck me is because there's only one point in 365 days when the sun stops moving. And it stops moving for 3 days. That's December 22nd, December 23rd, and December 24th. The ancients used to put out the sundial, and they could tell you what time of the year was based on the sundial. At that particular point, the sun reaches its lowest point at that point and appears to stop moving before it moves back the other way. So this is where you get the term, the sun dies for 3 days. They're not talking about the S-O-N, they're talking about the S-U-N. Okay, so understand what we're talking about. Nas is giving his concert on the day that the sun dies. He also being the son. Understand they're doing a twisted thing, and he's saying hip hop is dead because that's the day that the son dies. Do not think there's any coincidence or, you know what I'm saying, what's going on. He's performing a ritual right in front of our face. If he is the son, because he calls himself God's son, and we know that the son died for 3 days, and the S-O-N dies for 3 days, he's showing you that he's pulling off this ritual. And we know that the year is 2007 in a couple of weeks. 2 and 7 is 9. 9 represents completion. Over, finito, done. So we're moving into a new cycle. So what he's doing is he's killing this cycle. So people want to know why Nas is saying hip hop is dead. He's saying it on a whole nother level. For those who don't understand what's going on, they fighting over, they ain't dead, I'm still rhyming and shit, yo, so nonsense. But he's talking about something metaphysically is dead. And if hip hop was birthed in New York, then New York is the one that has to tell you when this particular cycle is dead. Even though what they doing in the South right now is dead. I'ma say it. However, they cannot be the ones who say hip hop is dead, because then we lose control of it. We birthed it, we kill it. And we birthed something else. Jay's new album is called Kingdom Come. All right, so I just showed you that after 3 days, the son ascends into the kingdom, right? Jay's new album is called Kingdom Come. Nas is now down with Jay-Z. They're pulling off a ritual right in front of our faces. All right? So when kingdom come, that's what Jay-Z is saying, when kingdom come, kingdom is here now, because Nas is about to die and ascend into the kingdom. All right? Nas's album drops on the 19th. 12-19. 12 and 9 and 19 is 31, last time I checked. Or 13. All depending on how you see it. Because 3 and 1 is 13. Am I correct? Christ and the 12 disciples, Jesus and the 12 disciples, is the number 13. However you look at it. We're dealing with the number 13. So I'm only breaking this down to you so you can understand that they fix these things and they're talking over our head in a language that a lot of us are not familiar with. And I told you, it's not about truth anymore, it's about the perception of truth. So they're fixing things mathematically, because if you're gonna do any kind of ritual work or magic, you must know when the stars is, you know, aligned up perfect. And also, December 22nd is the winter solstice. So understand that you can garner up energy during the winter solstice if you know what you're doing. If it's in your subconscious mind that you want to use, because all is mental. Our ancestors always taught all is mental. So if I mentally feel that I can manifest magic during this time, and maybe his career is getting catapulted into a whole nother level, because he's dying and then he's going to resurrect himself once again. You follow what I'm saying? So let's keep that in mind when we look at this. Give me a second here. Now, all right, this is the metaphysical breakdown. You know, we got 7 major chakras, or major wheels of life that spin in our body. We're nothing but light energy. All right, this, I just got finished explaining. This is the suit that we're wearing, and we're using it, and yada, yada, yada. So, the root chakra is red. That's the base of the spine. To the top of your spine, or you got 33 vertebrae. So the metaphysical breakdown of the Christ story is, once that energy ascends from the first vertebrae, and this is for all you Masons out there too, up to the 33rd vertebrae, you become illuminated or enlightened, and you begin to sit on the right side of the Father. So Christ is a Christ consciousness. It's not necessarily a person. When you're dealing with it metaphysically, we all are Christ. We all have the ability to ascend from our lower self to our higher self. So once you raise that kundalini energy up to 33 vertebrae, you sit on the right side of the Father. And like I said, Nas is 33 years old. So he's decided to say hip hop was dead when he was 33. Is it a coincidence? I don't think so. Coincidence is the language of the ancestors. And for those who know what time it is, they know what time it is. His last album came out 2 years ago. He was 31 or 13. You follow what I'm saying? Again, that's Christ energy. Jesus and the 12 disciples, whatever the case may be. So this is the metaphysical breakdown. You see what hell is. I don't know what happened. Might have got cut off a little bit. All right. You see what hell is, and you see what happened. It's just the raising of that energy from the base of the spine up the medulla oblongata, and now you illuminated because now you know the truth. You follow what I'm saying? And it's seven wheels of light, seven major wheels of light, which help you ascend. And once you activate each chakra, you become more and more enlightened. This is what the yogis are doing, sitting around meditating. They're trying to raise their consciousness and their energy all day. You know, they meditate for 40 days sometimes, 40 nights, trying to raise up that energy because they know that a lot of what's going on around us is bogging our energy down. Christ and God are the same people. I'm gonna say that again. Christ and or the devil and God are the same damn people. I'm just illustrating. When you vibrating on a low frequency, that's when you acting devil-like. You follow what I'm saying? That's when you the beast inside of you is prevalent. You follow what I'm saying? When you raise up that energy and understand who you are, you're one with the supreme consciousness, that's when you vibrating on your God-like head. Same person. It's just a matter of energy. It's like hot and cold. It's just two extremes of the same thing. Left and right, it's two extremes of the same thing. It's the same thing. It's temperature, or whatever the case may be. All right, the sun versus the sun, okay? The physical Christ has had 12 disciples, walked on water, if you want to get into that. And Jesus walked on water according to the good book. Jesus gave his life so that you may live. That's how the story goes. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Jesus was born on December 25th. Jesus died, you know, resurrected, and it's also associated with Easter, when he walked the earth again, or whatever the case may be. Spiritual, the sun, the S-U-N has 12 zodiacs that go around it. Maybe just coincidence, maybe not. The sun, when it's rising in the east, if you look at the water, it looks like it's walking on water. No matter how far back you are, once that sun is rising on the east, it looks like the reflection of it looks like it's walking on water. All right? The sun also gives its life so that we may live. If it ain't no sun, party over. We all agree, no plants, no fruits, no vegetables. It would just rain and flood the planet out. So we understand that the S-U-N also gives its life so that we may live. All right? The sun, too, is the light of the world. Can anybody here refute that in any way, shape, or form? It's the light of the world. The sun, too, was born again on December 25th, as I just explained. That it dies December 22nd, December 23rd, December 24th. This is science. You can find this in any book if you really go into it. And then it moves again on December 25th. This is where the whole story comes from. Easter is nothing more than the Eastern Star. Put the word Easter together, the shit damn near say Eastern Star. And we understand the Eastern Star is the sun. All right, so I wanted to show the correlation based on where you're vibrating at will determine, you know, what kind of information you pick up. If you want to only look at things on a physical level, because remember, physical is downstairs. Mental, mid-range, spiritual, upstairs. So we must begin to vibrate once again from who we truly are. We spiritual beings. But once we get caught and trapped in all the nigga business that's going on downstairs, it locks us into this negative frequency. And we don't even begin to grasp the concept of the, you know, the S-U-N. We get caught on to the S-O-N. All right? Everybody got that? Oh, okay, let's get into this. I wanted to show some of the methods used to break down and decode a lot of this information. So if you spread out the alphabet and you multiply everything by six, A-6, B for 12, C for 18, you know, yada, yada, yada. And then you spell the word New York. You might have seen this before. You get 666. May just be a coincidence. Try it at home. You don't need to pull out a pen and pad now to do it. Also, when you break down the word computer, you get 666. KKK or Ku Klux Klan, you get 666 twice. Double sixes. It was vibrating on something else. So, I did all that to say, if I decode the name Nas, you know, I didn't get 666, but I got a 6. Nasir, I got a 6. His last name is Jones. I got 18, which is 666. Because 6 plus 6 plus 6, keep in mind, you can't get trapped into one way of breaking down the formula because they don't operate like that. They got stuff hidden within stuff that's hidden, and they may subtract, they may multiply. You don't know how they're going to go about it. Whenever you see the number 18, also look at it as 666. And Esco, Nas calls himself Esco and shit. We got a 6 in there too. So if I wanted to say Nas, Nasir Esco, you get some 6s. His last name, like I said, you get 3 6s. I got Jay-Z. Now, what I found funny with Jay-Z is when I got the J, I got a 6. I got the A, I got a 6. I got the Y, it was 150. 1 and 5 is 6. I got 666 right there in his name. Hova, I got a 6. Sean Carter, when I added up all of that stuff, 834, 8 and 3 is 11. 11 and 4 is 5. 1 and 5 is 6. Got a 6 that Jigga, 204. Got 6s. May just be coincidence, but what we're doing is we're decoding. We're trying to paint a picture here to show you that, you know what I'm saying, they're talking to each other or their names vibrate on a certain frequency. All right, before we get there, I want to take a break. Is that cool? Can we get a break here? Because it's going to get really, really crazy in the second half of this. So I'm going to take a little break, and I guess 15 minutes maybe? All right, thank you. Thank you for the first half.